Oh, come on, put those hands together if you wanna go higher. Woo! My, 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 my. Lord have mercy.
Higher, higher, higher. We are the Mount Moriah Missionary Baptist Church of Pulaski, Mississippi, where Reverend Ralph James is our pastor. Thank you for joining today.
Blessing from the Lord, ready to receive a word from the Lord. Wherever you are, whatever you're doing right now, I just ask that you would pause just for a second and tell God thank you. Clap your hands, say hallelujah. Just lift up the name of Jesus because he is worthy to be praised. We just welcome you again to our services this morning. Another chance that to be able to lift up the name of Jesus, and we know that this is the day that the Lord has made and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Let us look to God and in prayer this morning as we open up our service. Most precious and holy God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for another opportunity, Lord, to be able to lift up your holy name, Lord. We thank you for bringing us through another week with storms and trials and tests, Lord. But you were there for us, Lord, covering us and keeping us through it all. So we just simply say, thank you, Lord. Father God, we don't know what tomorrow may hold, but we know this one thing for sure right now. We can lift up your name, Lord. So we just pray right now, Lord, any evil spirit, Lord, that is out there, Lord, that is in this place, Lord, that it might be there, Lord, we pray against it in the name of Jesus, Lord. And we ask that your Holy Ghost do what it always does. Just lead, God, direct, comfort, and move out, our Lord. Give us the freedom, Lord, to be able to praise and worship you, Lord. Anybody with something sick in their body this morning, I pray now that a word is released, Lord. Somebody that's dealing with depression, Lord, I pray that you would touch them this morning. Somebody dealing with financial issues this morning, I pray that you would touch them this morning. We just lift up your name this morning, Lord, because when your name goes up, when your name is lifted, Lord, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess that you are Lord, that you are King, that you are my Lord. So we just lift you up in this place this morning. And we pray and ask that you would have your way in this service, Lord. And for every viewer that is out there, for every person that comes in contact with Mount Moriah Missionary Baptist Church, Lord, we pray that their life would never be the same, Lord. And they would know you and the pardon of their sins, Lord. We just thank you for all things. In Jesus' name we pray this morning. Amen. Come on, lift up the name of Jesus this morning. Join in with our choir and with our deacons and sing with us this morning.
Go ahead. Our scripture this morning will be coming from Psalm 100. And it reads, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye land. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that has made us and not we ourselves. We are his peoples and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praises. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For he, the Lord, is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth through all generations. May the Lord add a blessing to the reader, the hearer, and his doer of his holy word.
Our Father, we come in the mighty name of Jesus, Lord. And as we come, we first just want to thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for lying down.
Yes, yes.
Place down.
Yes.
Thank you for a night that was restful and peaceful, Father. And Lord, we thank you for waking us up this morning. To this day that you have made that we've never seen before. One that we will never wake up to again. Lord, we thank you for just taking care of our families. Special prayer for those that are sick, not only in Mount Moriah Church, but throughout this land and country, Father.
Yes.
Special prayer we ask you, Father, and leader of this United States of America. Lord, you have a way that you can touch man's heart. Man can talk one to another, but you work from the inside out.
Yeah.
We ask you to look upon all of our hearts. May we have great intention through everything that we do. May we please you. May we serve you by loving our brothers and our sisters.
Yes.
Because you first loved us, Father. And Father, we pray that you would bless all of Mount Moriah members.
Please, Lord.
Touch the elders of this church.
Yes, Lord.
Keep them through this pandemic, Father. For you know when it began and you know when it's going to end, Father.
Yeah.
So we trust in you, God. And then, Lord, pray for all of our children. Father, may adults not pray on the children, and may they not pray on the elderly, for they are truly innocent in things that they might say or do. Then, Father, bless our pastor as he comes this morning.
Yes.
Bringing us the word that has been given unto him. May we not only listen, but help us to comprehend.
Yes.
Take it back in our homes, Father. In our community.
Yes.
In this church. And walk it, live it daily. That is truly a representation to man that you are our Savior and our Heavenly Father. These and all other blessings we ask you now, darling Son of Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen.
Way my
rise, but the God that we serve, Jesus the Christ, will fix any and every problem, trial, anything you got going on in your life. He'll fix it. I got some witnesses behind me. I got some witnesses out in front of me that know that he will fix it after a while. Somebody said a few days ago, it may not come when you want it, but oh, he's right on time. He shows up time and time again, just when we need him, just in the nick of time. We thank God for you all that have tuned in with us this morning to be a part of our services down here in Pulaski, Mississippi. We just appreciate those that have to come out and join in with us this morning and work through this pandemic. We're continue to find new ways to worship the Lord. So we just appreciate you taking out time this morning and coming in with us. And participating with us in worshiping the Lord. This morning, we got a couple of announcements that we want to make this morning. First and foremost, let me do this now because we will be having communion on today. So if you need to go get you a cup of water, some juice, and a cracker or bread, you got time to go ahead and do that now. We want to let you know that now so you'll be ready for communion as soon as I get done preaching. We'll be ready to go into our communion. We'll have one announcement that is October 31st, beginning around 7:30. We will have our fall festival, and there will be more details, and we'll have some slides that will be coming forth with that on our Facebook page. So please tune in and get ready for that. You won't have to get out of your vehicle. We know that is Halloween night. We know that our young people enjoy getting the candy and all that goes with that on Halloween night. So we're going to make provision for that to keep them not only safe when it comes to being in the community, but also we're going to try to make things a little bit safer as it pertains to this coronavirus that is out here. We thank God again for each and every last one of you all that have been with us down through these months of this pandemic, and you've been tuning in with us, be it Facebook or be it on our free conference call. You've been there for us, and we just continue to lift up the name of Jesus and thank God for you tuning into our services via social media and our parking lot service. We apologize this morning. We didn't know how the weather was going to be on today, so we did say that if you just wanted to stay at home this morning and not come out to the parking lot, it's totally understood. We understand that God does some things, and he allowed this storm to come through, and we didn't want to put you in harm's way. We didn't want to get you out on the road, and we're going to do the service from inside of the building totally today. So we just ask that you will forgive us for that. I know we had posted that we were going to be in the parking lot, but we had a conversation that said, let's not bring our members out in the middle of a storm or whatever might have been going on. But in spite of all that, we're still going to lift up the name of Jesus. Those are our announcements for this morning. Other than we will be having our Bible class on this Wednesday night. We had a good time this past Wednesday. We ask that you would tune in with us again on this upcoming Wednesday. Tell somebody about it so that they can tune in as well, and we can lift up the name of Jesus by way of teaching and learning about him. Also, we know that this month, as you can see, a few of us have on our pink. We know that this month is breast cancer awareness, or cancer period awareness, and being aware of that. So we want to speak directly to that this morning. Just want to say to each and every individual, be it male or female, make sure you're going to get your yearly checks and getting things checked on, because we know that cancer can be here today and then be gone tomorrow. And we also know that it can be gone tomorrow, no signs of it, and here today. And I believe every one of us have been affected in some type of way from this cancer, be it immediate family or friend, some kind of way we've been affected. So please make sure that you are getting your yearly checkups and everything that goes behind that in your health. Be mindful that it's not an easy thing to do, but we have members of Mount Moriah Missionary Baptist Church who have a testimony, and we're praying that God will release their testimony, because we know that we overcome by our testimony. And we know that others go through this thing and they've made it through. Some have made it through by the way of physical healing. Some have made it through by the Lord has called them home to be with them. And we know that to live is Christ and to die is gain. So we just want to now at this time have about a 10 to 15 second moment of silence for those that have gone on due to this cancer. At this time now, we'll transition a little bit, and we'll move over into our offering time now. We know that we have four ways of giving. You can go through our app, which is the Givelify app. If you want to sow seeds into the ministry, just go on Givelify and search Mount Moriah Missionary Baptist Church. search Mount Moriah Missionary Baptist Church in Pulaski, Mississippi, and it'll come right up, and you can sow as God has directed you to sow. Give your tithes and your offerings there. You can go to our website, Mount Moriah MMBC, and you can find us there. You can bring it into the church. So there are just different ways that you can give. Understand and know this, and my pastor told me this, you have not fully worshiped until you have given in the offering, because it is a part of the service. So the Lord leads you to give, just so just do as the Lord has directed, and we appreciate that. You have been doing a great job. Members of Mount Moriah continuing to carry on in the middle of this pandemic. So we just appreciate you. We just appreciate you for continuing to be faithful in your giving, or your tithes and your offering.
Reverend Baker,
everybody
see him, he
said
he's
on. Hey amen. Those of y'all who may not have been able to hear Reverend Macon sing his offer, so we thank God for them. They've been doing well during this pandemic, and we just appreciate them for continuing to love on their church. At this time now, we ask them, Elmer, if you would give us a word of prayer.
Yes, Lord, we thank you for this opportunity, portion of the service, which is very important to give. Lord, we pray that each one had to give and had to desire.
Yes.
Be blessed to do so next time if they did not. Lord, let it be used for the purpose and the spirit for which it was given. Let your word go on. Your kingdom would be up, and we ask it all now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. We just thank God for each and every last one of you again for what you have done. Again, be reminded that we will have communion immediately following the sermon. So if you need to go get you some crackers, some juice, whatever you need to get to partake, please go ahead and do that now so you can be right there with us as we participate. Remember the Lord doing what he did for us. At this time now, we will have a song, and then we'll have the preached word. I'm sorry.
In honor of Breast Cancer Awareness Month, the Media and Communications Ministries would like to acknowledge a couple health facts regarding breast cancer. Breast cancer is a disease in which malignant cancer cells form in the tissues of the breast. 1 in 8 women in the U.S. will be diagnosed with breast cancer in her lifetime. This year, an estimated 42,170 women will die from breast cancer in the U.S. However, there are over 3.5 million breast cancer survivors here. In addition, men are diagnosed with breast cancer too, but it is very rare. It is very important to get a mammogram check for your health. This has been a message brought to you by the Media and Communications Ministry.
Somebody's on the job, somebody's in this building this morning, and they've been dealing with some things for a long time. Lord, we're praying now that you would send the word that would comfort them, Lord. But not only will it comfort them, Lord, but it would heal and deliver and set free. Thank you, Lord, for your son Jesus Christ dying on the cross. Lord, we pray now, Lord, that you would move me out of the way. Let your Holy Ghost have his way, God. God, I pray now that you would just slow me down this morning, because I'm already excited. I'm ready to go on home from here, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, God. Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord. We thank you for all things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Won't y'all just give God a hand clap of praise? Amen. Amen. This morning we're not going to trouble you long. We're going to come from Matthew chapter 13, beginning at the 31st verse, verse 32. We'll be reading from the King James Version. Again, we're coming from Matthew chapter 13, beginning at the 31st verse. Very, very familiar passage of scripture. And I know I say that all the time, but at this point on this journey, it shouldn't be too many scriptures that you hadn't heard. It's not familiar somewhere down in your spirit. And if you're just coming to the Lord, just stick around for a while and you'll get some of these down off of your spirit. Give you something to run on and see what the end is going to be. Matthew chapter 13, beginning at the 31st verse, says, "Another parable put he forth unto them, saying, The kingdom of heaven is like to a grain of mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in his field, which indeed is the least of all seeds, but when it is grown, it is the greatest among herbs, and becometh a tree. So that the birds of the air come and lodge in the branches thereof." Just for a little while, if you would just give me your attention, and let's talk about the power of small things. The power of small things. Here we are in 2020, and I say this, and I sometimes feel like I say it too much, but here we are in the year of 2020, and God has just thrown us one of the greatest things that we as a country, our world has experienced in a very long time. This coronavirus, this pandemic, has slowed us down and knocked us off of our feet and allowed us to be able to sit back and really realize what is going on in this country of these United States of America. As I look at this from my perspective, I say this again, and I said it on the last meeting Sunday that we had, it's simply just that this is the year of vision. God has allowed us to really see who is in charge and who is in control. No matter what may go on in your life, you got to understand and you got to know that God is always in charge and in control.
That's
We had no control over whether this pandemic came to the United States of America or not. We had no control over whether or not we contracted the virus, or we were a carrier of the virus, or we were asymptomatic, or we just don't have the virus. We have no control over that. We had no control over all the hurricanes that came through. We're all the way up to Delta, and Delta came through. It was sitting out there in the Gulf of Mexico as a 4, but it hit ground. When it hit land, it became a 2. Here I am this morning to tell somebody the power of small things. As you probably know, the mustard seed is one of the smallest seeds that is here in the world. It's planted in the Middle East, and if nurtured in the right conditions, it can grow into something resembling a small tree. Hear me well, let me say that again. If it's nurtured in the right way, it can grow into something resembling a small tree. But here we are, we're looking at the beginning stages. Somebody say, I'm looking at the beginning stages. You yourself at one time were just a small seed. But look at you now. The power of small things. Here it is, this small seed, which was so very small at one time. If it was planted in the ground and the right water and the right nutrients got on that seed, it began to blossom. It began to bud and come up out of the ground. And as it came up out of the ground, if nobody picked it and it stayed in the right conditions, it became a small tree. It provides a haven or a safe place for the birds. It's amazing what a tiny little seed can become. When we look at the text this morning, it simply says, and in the book of Matthew chapter 13, it's a few parables before it, but we get down to this parable and we have to have understanding behind this grain of a mustard seed. We say it so many times in our Christian journey. If I could just have a little faith, just a mustard seed faith, God can move mountains. God can do this for me. God can take me from being sick to being healed. He can take me from being broke to being wealthy. He can take me from being over here in this bad place and setting me on a hill and out of the valley, away from all the hurt, harm, and danger. Remember the power of small things. Faith is just like that. You don't need a whole lot of it, but you need just a little bit to remind you that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You need just a little bit of faith just to remember that I am the head and not the tail. You need just a little bit of faith to know that you are a conqueror and that there is nothing that this world can throw at you to be able to defeat you, because the last time I checked, if you were in the hand of Jesus Christ, the last time I checked, you were victorious in any and everything. Come with me. As we travel down through this thing and understanding the power of small things. If you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you can say to the mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. That's what it tells us over in Matthew chapter 17 and verse 20. Now, the first time I read this passage, I thought it meant that God gives us power so we can impress our unbelieving friends and show off to them. But no, my brothers and my sisters, I'm here to tell you that God is trying to speak more to you than just being able to impress your friends and your family. God may bless you with a house sitting on a hill. He may bless you with an Infinity you can drive around in front of everybody else. He may bless you with a BMW. He may be able to bless you with all these tangible things where you can put on expensive suits and wear the most expensive hair and eyebrows and eyelashes and all that type of stuff. He may do that for you, but it's not so that you can show off to your friends. The Bible also says that God takes our sins and he casts them in the depths of the sea. I just believe this ultimately means that if you invest a small, childlike faith in God, he can forgive your mountain of sins and cast them into the deepest depths of the ocean. So basically what I'm saying is, it doesn't matter how far you're out there. You may be a drug dealer. You may be a prostitute. You may be out there doing people wrong. It doesn't matter what you've done. You're never too far outside of the reach of God that he can't forgive your sins and cast them into the sea to never be thought of again. Scripture tells us in Romans 3 and 23 that all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And let me just stick a pin right there and talk about this thing called sin, because we got to understand that sometimes we in the church world got this thing confused. We think that because we have accepted Jesus Christ that everything is going to be right, and you're not going to do some things that are disobedient or some things that God is not pleased with. But I'm a living witness that every day that I wake up, I think something that I shouldn't think, or I say something that I shouldn't say. So there's a sin even though I have accepted Jesus Christ. God has told me to do some things and I've gone the other way. I've sinned in disobedience. I've sinned by looking at other people and judging them, saying that they know better and they should be better by now. I've sinned, and if surely if I sinned, I believe that I got one or two witnesses out there that can witness to the fact that you sinned. Let me not hold you long this morning. Let me get to my first point. My first point is, don't underestimate the power of small things. Matthew 25 and 21 says, his Lord said unto him, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord." As the text tells us this morning, that broken down simply saying, when God gives you just a little bit, be faithful and take care of that little bit so that he can move you on up just a little bit higher. Don't underestimate the power of the small things in your life. Don't underestimate the fact that God gave you a job making $9.25 an hour and he moved you on because you were faithful. You were on time for your job. When they did you wrong, you still showed up, put a smile on your face, and still did what God called you to do. Don't ever underestimate the small things, because we didn't always have what we have now. We didn't always drive around in Cadillacs and have the biggest house on the street. We didn't always have the finest clothes. I remember a time when I was probably around 16 or 17 and everybody else around me wearing Nikes and having the finer clothes of life. And here I am just thankful to be able to have clothes on my back. So don't forget about it. Don't underestimate the power of the small things that God has allowed to come into your life. And I'm going somewhere with this, so if y'all would just journey with me. Point number two says, small things lead to greater things. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20, coming from the NIV. It says, "Now unto him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we could ask or imagine, according to his power that worketh in us." And I love that word right there. And I went to the NIV because it says immeasurably. You see, you got to understand that through the course of life, when I was a young child and my granddaddy was a carpenter, and he was out there and he was showing me how to read the ruler and how to make the perfect cut. And we were measuring the wood because you had to be cut at a certain length so it would fit and do what it's supposed to do. But the text tells us this morning that now unto him who's able to do immeasurably more than we could ask or imagine. So the things that you're thinking about, the things that you want to ask God about, he's got more on his mind for you than that. So if you think you're going to be a millionaire, he can maybe take you to be a billionaire. If all you want to be is a doctor, then he can make you be the best doctor in your hospital, in your career field. If all you want to be is a lawyer, then he can make you the best lawyer in your area. If you just want to be a garbage man, he'll make you be the best garbage man that you can be, because you can only think so much. He said that his thoughts and our thoughts are as far away as the heavens and the earth. If you can just imagine yourself being what you want to be, God's got something greater on his mind for you. But the good thing about that scripture is, not only is it immeasurable what he's thinking about us, but the good thing about it is that power that worketh within us. That power that worketh within us. Remember, don't forget about the small things, or the power of the small things. There's a power that's on the inside of you. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, there's a power that's working on the inside of you. Now let me run back to that little mustard seed, and let's talk about that thing and the power that it takes to get that little bitty seed to get its roots to come up out of the ground. To get its roots to be able to come up where the sun can actually beam down on it. Ah, I see you, Holy Ghost. Here I am this morning, and I'm just this mustard seed. And here I am, and I've been nurtured by everything that's in the ground. I've been nurtured by the water that's been coming down and feeding me because I was thirsty. And here I am, I'm this little seed, and I'm trying to break out of this shell. I want to speak to somebody. You've been going through some trials and some tribulations. You've been battling with generational curses, and God is trying to break you out of your mold, trying to break you out of what you think you should be and get you to where he wants you to be at. It's not going to be easy. The road is not going to be straight. It's going to be crooked. It's going to be some valleys. It's going to be some stuff, some rocks to fall in your way. But here I am this morning to tell you there's a power that worketh on the inside of you. And that power that's on the inside of you is going to lead you to greater things. It may not look like it's going to take you anywhere because you're working on a job making $9.25 an hour. But because you've been faithful, and because you've been faithful over a few things, you never know who may come into that job and look you in your face and simply say, I like your work habits. I've been coming here for a while, and I see that you're here. You got a smile on your face. Even when the storms of life are raging, you still got a smile on your face. I'm just wondering if you would be able to come and sit down with me. I want to offer you a job, and I want to take you from making $9.25 an hour, and I want to put you in making $25 an hour because of your faithfulness. Not just simply to the job, but because of the fact you got pride in yourself. You know that you're going to work until the way that God wants you to work. You're working as if you're working for the Lord. And because you're doing that, the Lord is working on your behalf in a spiritual sense. He's working where you can't see him at. And he'll set somebody up to be able to come into your life and take you from one level to another level. Small things lead to greater things. Let me not hold you any longer. Let's look at our last and final point this morning. It simply says, speak the word with power. Proverbs 18 and 21 says, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. Mm-hmm. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. The things that you say, the things that you're doing, it's going to carry something with it. There's weight with it. So if you're going to think about things in life and start speaking them, make sure you're speaking positive things. Make sure you're doing things in the way that God would have you do it, because it says death and life are in the power of the tongue. So when that boss comes in and they telling you this and they telling you that, or that co-worker is doing this and that against you, all sorts of evil against you, remember that death and life are in the power of the tongue. When things arise in your life and you start realizing that it's the things that you're saying that are allowing things to manifest. I said I want to be at this level by this age, and I've worked hard to get there, and I'm still not there, Lord. I just want to just tell you, Lord, I need you to show up. I need you to show up in my life on my behalf. And the old soul writer simply said, I need thee. Oh, I need thee. Every now and then. Along this journey, it gets rough and it gets tough, but you got to remember that you just can simply hold up your hand and sing the old spiritual hymn and say, I need thee, Lord, I need thee. Every hour, I need thee. Hey, I need thee. Bless me now, my Savior, I need thee. Speak the word with power. Because when it gets down in there, it says, I come to thee, Lord, I need thee. Speak the word with power, and know that the more power you speak, and the more you speak to your situation, you can say to that mountain, be thou removed, and the mountain will move. You can say to the enemy that I am the head and not the tail. You can say to that problem, that trial, and all those fights that you're having to deal with, that God fights my battle. You can say to whatever's going on in your life, I've got victory! In spite of what they're saying about me, I've got victory. In spite of how I feel about myself, I've got victory. You gotta hold on, if you will, just let me grab one witness to this fact. Just one little witness to this fact. If you look in John chapter 6, you'll see a little boy had two fish and five barley loaves. He took those two little fish and five pieces of bread, and he fed thousands upon thousands of people with two fish and five loaves.
I'm here to remind somebody this morning the power of small things. If I can grab me another witness, we can look at old Samson over there in Judges chapter 15. He took the jawbone of an ass and he slew an army. Just a little bit of jawbone killed an entire army. If you look over in 1 Samuel chapter 17, David and Goliath were there. You may have some giants in your life. And with these giants, it seems like you're never going to be able to pass them, never going to be able to get through them. But if you just remember the story of little old David, who had just a little power within the stone that he threw. See, what you got to understand this morning is just understanding that the simple fact that it don't take a whole lot to do a little bit of something. All it took was that little bit of stone. And David took it, and out of obedience, he picked that stone up and he put it in that slingshot. And as he was there looking up at his giant, he took that old little bitty rock. And if you would let me use my preacher imagination this morning, I'm just maybe that little rock he had was just a little bitty prayer. And that giant that he was dealing with was a simple fact that he was dealing with generational curses. Maybe that giant that he was dealing with was a financial issue. Maybe that giant that he was dealing with was sickness in his body. Maybe that giant issue that he was dealing with was something on the job. Maybe it was something within his family. Just maybe it was a pandemic in his life. And as he was standing there picking up those stones, I can imagine him looking back over his life, if you would, just look back over your life and think about how many times God has brought you through. And the reason he brought you through simply was this right here. When you reached down and you got in your prayer closet and you began to cry out to your Father in heaven, simply saying, Father, Father, I stretch my hand to thee. No other help I know. I've tried drugs. I've tried alcohol. I've tried women. And I've tried all sorts of evil. But every time I turn around, you keep working it out for me. So here I am, just a simple little boy. I've got this giant, and his name is Goliath. Whatever your giant is, I dare you to call it out. I dare you to believe with me the power in small things. Just a little prayer will change things. Just a little praise will change things. Just a little worship will change things. So baby, as you sat there, began to whine and whistle, and he began to get ready to swing that rock. All he did was believe. He believed that his Father in heaven would heal his pain, would move his heartache, would set him free, would take him from being small to being large. Yeah, the God we serve, there's power in small things. Just a little thing. Great things can be accomplished. Great things can be accomplished. I had to slow myself down there because there's a point that I need to make for some of the young people that's out there. And maybe you may not be considered young anymore, but I need to remind you of a few small things. Just a little note in your life can take you to higher heights. Let me say that again. Just a no in your life can take you to higher heights. Watch this. Let's bring this all the way up to our times. For our young little boys that's out there, there was a man by the name of Michael Jordan who, when he was in high school, his coach told him, no, you can't play on the team. But he didn't stop right there. He decided that he was going to go work and do what it takes to make the team the next year. So as he was traveling through his journey over that summer, He worked hard on his jumper. He worked hard on dribbling. He worked hard on his endurance. And his no became the next, the yes the next year. And look at what happened to Michael Jordan. His no propelled him to greater things. Let me help some young lady out there. Maya Angelou was best known for her literary works. She wrote poems as though we can remember. But as a young child, she wanted to be a director. Somebody told her no. And it took her all the way until she was at 70 years old before she was finally given a chance to direct her first film. So what I'm trying to tell somebody out there, you may have been told no yesterday and it hurt you and it broke your spirit, but you kept working, you stayed on the battlefield, and at the age of 70, you may walk into your greater thing. I'm telling somebody this morning, don't forget about the power of the small thing. You still don't know who I'm talking about, but let me remind you of a woman named Oprah Winfrey who was told no in the very beginning, but she kept working hard and now she's a billionaire. I'm here to tell somebody that no, use that no to propel you to higher heights. Let it take you somewhere else. Yeah, Lord, let it take you somewhere else. Somebody may have told you no today. They may have told you no yesterday, but keep working. Because one day, God is going to take you to higher heights. With your no, let it propel you to higher heights. And as I get ready to go to my seat this morning, let me tell you about another man who, if it had not been for him, we wouldn't be where we are. I know you think I'm talking about the barefoot Nazarene, but we ain't there yet. I got just a few more minutes. I'm talking about a man named Judas. I hear you saying, why are you talking about Judas? I'm talking about Judas because Judas sold my Savior for 30 pieces of silver. That 30 pieces of silver, it was small in the eyesight of a rich man. It was small in the eyesight of those that were wealthy. But that 30 pieces of silver moved my Savior into place to begin one of the greatest things to ever happen in life. So understand, just because somebody talks about you, just because somebody betrays you, just because somebody does you wrong, doesn't mean that's the end of the story. You see, after he sold my Jesus for 30 pieces of silver, they began to lie on him. They began to talk about him. They put him in a courtroom and they told him that they needed to carry him to the cross. They didn't understand that that small little issue of selling him for 30 pieces of silver was going to be such a great thing for you and for me. So as he went on and they whooped him and they beat him, they hung him on an old rugged cross. They took him down off the cross and they put him in a borrowed tomb. And here I am in this borrowed tomb. You may be locked up in your life right now, feeling like you're not going to make it. But I'm here to tell you to just look back at Jesus, how they did him. And if they did him that way, surely they'll do you the same way. But it was there when they thought the story was over. They thought it was over. But he did something that no other man had ever done. He stayed in the earth for 3 long days. But early one Sunday morning, somebody say he got up. He got up. He got up. With all power in his hand. And with that all power in his hand, it took that small thing of dying to take us to greater places. You see, he said it in his words, I'm here to do something, but greater things you will do. Don't forget about the small things that God has in your life. The power of small things. The power of small things. It's the power. The power of the small things that happen in your life. You may receive a no in your life, but that no should activate you and move you to higher heights. When you're working on the battlefield for the Lord, when you're in this journey, the load will get heavy. Friends and loved ones will forsake you. They'll talk about you. that won't understand the moves that you're making. But it's the small things. When you look at the big picture. What we gotta understand is sometimes, and I said this on Wednesday night, sometimes we can't see the picture because we're in the picture. But if you just take a moment to look at the bigger picture, when you're going through your trials, when you're dealing with life, dealing with sickness in your body. Whew. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. When you're dealing with financial problems, for that young mother out there, that you're doing it all by yourself. For that father that's out there, you're doing it by yourself. You're in the picture right now. The God that we serve, we know that Jesus was a carpenter. He built things. He's building you. He's making you. He's molding you. Scripture tells us that we're like clay. He's the potter. He's making us. It's the small things that happen in our life that propel us to the greater things. No matter what your age is, no matter what your background is, you've been told no once before. It's up to you what you do with that no. As long as you're doing something that is in God's will, as long as you're doing something that is morally right, as long as you're staying in the will and that no shows up, all I keep hearing in my spirit is it's just delayed, not denied. See, we live in an age right now, and God has blessed me to be somewhat of a manager on the job, and I deal with young people between the age of 18, 19, and about 28, 29, 30, 33. And I didn't understand when I was those ages, but now I understand, because God was making me in those ages. And I'm here to say to some of the young people that may be watching us this morning, you're in the picture frame. You're the house that's being built. You don't understand why your finances don't do what you think they ought to do. You don't understand why this friend did you that way, or you don't understand why your boss is treating you that way. I'm here to tell you that God is making you through every one of those situations. But if you would just take out a moment to be patient and let God make you and mold you, not him, not her, not the job, not the degree, let God make you. Have patience. Everything is going to work out for your good. It's not going to feel good. It's not going to look good, but it's going to work for your good. The power of the small things. This morning, you may be sitting in your living room on the job, riding in your car, listening to us this morning. I just want to offer this to you. I just want to say to you this morning, that just simply believing in Jesus Christ and confessing with your heart that God has, confessing with your mouth that God has raised him from the dead, is just a small step into greater things. You may be sitting there and you may have tears streaming down your face because you've been dealing with sickness. You've been dealing with family problems. You've been dealing with financial problems. You've been dealing with all sorts of issues in your life and you can't find the answer. Tell you, like I would tell the woman that had the issue of blood for 12 long years, who searched and searched and searched and searched and couldn't find the answer. Jesus is passing through. And if you just take your belief and touch the hem of his garment and just believe that he can heal you and make you whole, I'm a living witness. I got some witnesses around me that he will immediately make your life whole. The power of small things. If you would repeat after me this morning, if you're sitting at home and you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, I would ask now that you would say, Lord, I believe that God raised Jesus from the dead, and I confess it with my mouth that he is a risen Savior. Lord, come into my life and save me. If you prayed that prayer this morning, I would just ask that you would reach out to us, to our Facebook page, get in touch with us some kind of way, so that we can rejoice with the fact that you have accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. If you want to become a member here at Mount Moriah, we can do that. If you want to become a member somewhere else, we can put you in a place where you can do that. The power of small things. As we look at this thing, I keep running back to this. You can search all over, and there's nobody. There's no one that would be able to do what Jesus has done for you. You can look high. You can look low. You still won't find nobody. There's nobody greater. Nobody greater. Nobody greater than Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for dying on an old rugged cross. Your communion ready. We want to have prayer this time.
and often as we do this, we ought to do it in remembrance of our Father. Thank you, Jesus. At this time now, we're also going to have our, before we have our communion, we're going to have our, what we would call our virtual altar call. There's a name that you need called out. Call it out. Write it in the comments. You can move forward from there. Oh, thank you, Jesus. I'd like to call out Craig Morgan, the Morgan family. Joe Bond. Thank you. All those affected by the coronavirus. Pray for our government leaders, from the highest office down to the last person elected. So we're getting ready to go into election season. All those candidates that are running, pray for them as well. Let us look to God, most precious, powerful, prolific Savior. As we come to you this morning, Lord, we come crying out, saying, Lord, thank you. Thank you for saving us. You didn't have to do it, but because of your love, your grace, and your mercy, you hung on that old rugged cross. God, we pray now for every individual, for the names that have been called, the names on the sick and the shut-in list, the names that weren't called, that somebody may have just thought about, Lord. Just pray for them, Lord. You know the problem. You know the situation. But, Lord, we know you to be a miracle worker. And we pray that you would touch, heal, and deliver. God, somebody needs you to set them free, Lord. Yes. They've been battling with some things, and we need you to set them free, God. Somebody's laying in the hospital, Lord, laying on their deathbed. God, we need you to touch this morning.
Yes, Lord.
God, you're the author and the finisher of our faith, God. God, I'm leaning on your behalf.
Yes, God.
Heal the body, Lord. Heal the mind. Give one more chance, God, to somebody that needs it, Lord. Somebody needs just a few more seconds to say, Lord, I believe. Give it to them, Lord. Give it to them, Lord. God, we're experiencing death all over this world, Lord. We pray and ask that you would just look on those bereaved families, Lord. Be a comforter in the midnight hour. God, we thank you for our jobs. We thank you for our co-workers. We thank you for all those around us in our circle, Lord. We even thank you for our enemies, Lord. Thank you for preparing a table in the presence of our enemies, God. We just thank you for them, Lord. We thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for the valley moments, Lord. Because without them, Lord, we can't appreciate sitting on the mountaintop, Lord. Keep us humble as you take us to greater things, Lord. Keep us humble, God. Lord, continue to work with us on the inside. Give us strength, Lord, to be able to show it on the outside, Lord. Thank you for Mount Moriah Church family, Lord. God, you're taking us to greater heights. God, I just heard it in the spirit again. Better days ahead. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. God, we just thank you for all things. Thank you for this morning, Lord. Now, Lord, as we get ready to partake in communion, Lord, we pray now that you forgive us all of our sins, Lord. Cleanse us, Lord, so that we'll be able to serve you, so that we'll be able to take this communion, Lord, and we won't drink damnation unto our souls, Lord. God, we thank you for all, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Hopefully by now you have your communion, your bread, your water, your juice, your Sprite, whatever you got at home. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me, Lord. We just thank you for dying on the old the rugged cross. I know it was the blood that set me free. I know it was the blood that set me free. Hey. And I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood for me. One day when I was lost, he died upon the cross. And I know it was the blood for me.
Because of his death, burial, and resurrection, we have the right to eat together and to drink together.
Amen.
Amen. We thank God for each and every last one of you all that has tuned in with us this morning on our Facebook Live. We pray that you have a blessed and a wonderful weekend. Just know this, there's power in small things. Now may the grace of God, the sweet communion of his Holy Spirit rest, rule now, henceforth, and forever. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Y'all be blessed out there in Facebook land. If y'all need us, let us know. God bless you. Y'all have a good week.